Funding for Shaperillus is provided by
Surfshark VPN, the sponsor of today's video.
Hey friendos, it's me, Shaperillus, here today to talk about the most epic movie that I think has ever existed and will ever exist. My friends discovered it a few months back, and it quickly became a meme among us, so I watched it for myself, and it is a true cinematic treasure. An underrated gem. A misunderstood masterpiece. A film that will stand the test of time and be remembered in the annals of cinema for eons to come. We're talking about C.I. Ape.
Who was that funky monkey?
What is C.I. Ape about, you may ask? It's about an ape. And he works with the CIA. I know, you would never get that from the title, but it's surprisingly true. This movie, which was distributed by Lionsgate? What the fuck? That's like a real ass movie studio. How did that happen? Does this mean we can get a Hunger Games CIA crossover where he wrecks shit up and murders Katniss, cementing his place as the most epic Hunger Gamer of all time? Can we get CIA versus John Wick where the two of them are tricked into fighting each other, but then realize Jesse Eisenberg killed both of their dogs and that they have so much in common, so they team up to beat up his giant meatball monster with the help of... let's see, who else does Liongate own? Madea? God, one can only hope. Oh wait, sorry, I'm getting ahead of myself. Anyway, this movie is just so epic and awesome that we're now gonna take a look at all of its epicness and awesomeness together. So C.I. Ape opens at this epic building where these guards are guarding something from a bad CGI cat. Okay, I'll excuse this one bad CGI animal, but if we have any more bad CGI animals during this movie, I will not be a happy camper. We then cut to a mission control facility that appears to be run by children, because it is run by children, and they give the go-ahead to their operative Sam, who as it turns out, is the titular CIA. I just said I didn't want any more bad CGI animals in this movie, and clearly the movie listens because this is just the greatest CG of all time. Look at this beautiful specimen. This movie's effects put Dune to shame. Make a real movie like this one, Denis Villeneuve, you hack!
What's in the box? Monkey.
We're 5x5, but time is of the essence.
I'm going as fast as I can.
Oh, he can talk. Okay. I'm sure his ability to speak will be a vital part of this movie that definitely couldn't have been cut out of the movie entirely going forward. Also, why can this ape speak? Where did he come from? Prepare to take those questions to the grave, fuckers. You don't need to know C.I. Ape's origin story or why he can talk. He's C.I. goddamn Ape. You're lucky he's even gracing you with his presence in this movie. Don't be greedy.
It's only 6 a landing. Don't leave me hanging.
Miss James, please. This is a serious mission.
Yeah, Miss James. The mission with the talking ape is serious. Thank you very much, you piece of shit.
The future of our democracy may depend on it.
So C.I. Ape does some epic stealthy maneuvers, but then decides to reveal himself to a guard after he gets the data he needs, because he's a mischievous little scamp.
How did you get in here?
Zipline grappling hook stuck by the guards and through the ventilation shaft.
A talking ape?
I prefer chimp.
Oh, okay, my bad. I don't know why I called him an ape this whole time. Maybe it's because it's the name of the fucking movie?
Monkey?
We're only 5 minutes in, but I hope you can tell by now why this is the greatest movie of all time. I like how this guy shouts we've been breached to nobody in particular, and then radios in that the other guard should lock it down.
We've been breached! Lock it down! Lock it down!
I don't know what it is, and I don't know why he didn't say that before following C.I. Ape down the stairs and shouting we've been breached to nobody in particular. I love when these other guards show up, but they don't chase after C.I. Ape until this guy points to him. Like they need confirmation that the monkey dressed like a spy running away from them is indeed the thing that they need to chase down. Okay, I'm not gonna say every funny thing in the opening scene because we'd be here for hours, but this part is truly amazing. I feel like this moment perfectly encapsulates the quality of this movie. So three armed guards see C.I. Ape and tell him to freeze. They don't point their guns at him, they just say freeze, and he radios in a little help. So the girl back at command hacks into the fire alarm and activates the sprinklers, which stops the bad guys because I guess they can't use their guns or do anything at all while they're wet. Apparently these bad guys are all secretly Roy Mustang, who knew? And then the girl says,
silly bad guys, you can't have a lockdown as a fire alarm. Everybody knows that.
What? Does everybody know that? Is that some sort of common knowledge I wasn't aware of? And then, after that epic zinger of a line, she proceeds to stand up and do a Fortnite dance, I guess? Why is this movie like this? And why can't all movies be like this? Now, CIA has to fight a bunch of dudes, and the fight choreography is just mwah, chef's kiss, c'est magnifique. This leads perfectly into the line that leads us perfectly into the opening titles.
Who was that funky monkey?
God himself. That's who he was. The movie just started and it's already the ride of a lifetime. And don't worry, it just gets more magnificent from here. So now everyone from the CIA agency is just chilling at the park. Sun's out, fun's out, baby. CIA uses a frisbee to knock a hot dog out of the old general guy's hands, and he is pissed. So he just chucks the frisbee away, and it nearly hits some random bystander at the park. But don't worry, our hero CIA would never let innocence get hurt, so he saved her life by catching the frisbee. Wonderful job. Meanwhile, the girl from the agency is talking to this other guy from the agency, and he is striking out hard.
Have you always wanted to work with the monkey?
He's not a monkey. He's a chimpanzee, and he hates being called a monkey.
Oh, my bad.
I hate it too.
I thought it was kind of funny because, you know.
No, I don't. It's funny why.
Just give up, bro. This is so embarrassing. So in the next scene, we meet the girl's dad, and we find out that her parents are getting divorced. Oh no! Don't worry, this detail is not important, and it's not relevant to anything else that happens in the movie. It's just funny that they throw in such a cliche plot point just because, I don't know, I guess we needed some filler before the next epic CIA action sequence.
She's not too happy with me, is she?
She just needs some time.
What is this family's relationship to this talking secret agent chimp? I am so confused.
Bondi, young lady, what did I just say?
Oh, her name is Bondi James. I get, did you get it? It's like the spy movie guy from the movies. Do you get it? Do you get it?
It's a text from unknown number.
Somebody's got a crush on you.
Or it could be a stalker. Or a telemarketer. Last week I got a text from Ted Cruz about a campaign rally. How did that piece of shit get my number and how do I block him? Bondi didn't even say what the contents of the message were. Why does this mom assume it's from someone with a crush on her? Anyway, whatever. It's time for a mission briefing. There's a mysterious guy they gotta go after.
What was he arrested for?
Loitering.
Hanging around with no purpose. Some guys are just born bad.
Why is this girl so weird?
He looks sad.
Of course he's sad. He's a bad guy. Bad guys are sad by definition. If they weren't sad, they wouldn't be bad guys.
Yeah.
Aaron Sorkin is shitting his pants at the revelation that he can't write dialogue this good. Then the old guy starts rambling about milk and how you can't let it expire.
Sure, it smells all right today, but what about tomorrow? Pour a tall glass. And that's when it hits you. Pow!
Oh my god! Because it's a metaphor. Because this guy who's evil is milk that's about to expire.
What I'm trying to say is this guy is milk with an approaching expiration date.
And just to drive the point home, he also has a glass of expired milk next to him that he drinks. I am deeply concerned that this mission is being headed by a senile old man.
Finish your milk before the expiration date, before it turns on you.
The villain is here on Wolf Tooth Island, and CIA has to infiltrate it, so he and Bondi say goodbye. Oh wait, actually no, she just says goodbye while he responds non-verbally, because I guess the writers just forgot he could talk here. But then he talks 10 seconds later when he asks if there are sharks in the water. And there are, just so we can have a cool slow motion shot of a shark almost eating him. And then nothing else, that's it, that's all they needed the sharks for, okay, whatever. Meanwhile, at the White House, question mark? We get to meet the villain, Alpha Dog, and his henchman, Dr. Devious, who are making two evil robot dogs that don't work at all. And honestly, if I can just remove the mask of irony and sarcasm for a second, I genuinely kind of think the banter between these guys is a little bit funny.
Oh, attacking? Is that part of the plan? I didn't know that.
Is attacking part of the plan to take over the world? Is that a serious question, Doctor?
Like, if there's one thing I can never knock this movie for, it's that all of the actors are committed. They're definitely having a good time with this fucking insane movie. Anyway, CIA is spying on these two, but then some random little girl finds him. It turns out she's Alpha Dog's daughter, and she's just wandering around his evil lair for some reason.
Code Red! Agent discovered! I repeat, Agent has
discovered.
Calm down, Miss James. The agent is an expert at covert operations. Remember the time he posed as a Hollywood producer and actually won an Oscar?
What the fuck? I want to see that movie. That sounds amazing.
Aw, it's her birthday today and her dad didn't remember, so CIA gives her a hug. But then he's gotta run because Alpha Dog heard something.
Thought I heard something out here.
Yeah, well, of course you heard something. When the robot dog escaped, it left a big gaping hole between the room you were in and the hallway where your daughter was talking to CIA. How did you not hear something sooner? Oh well, the point is he's a bad dad and an even worse supervillain. How sad. Meanwhile, back at HQ, we find out that the person who texted Bondi earlier was the down bad kid. What a surprise. Why did he creepily just text her hi? Why does he have her number when she doesn't have his?
His identity is a secret. How can you possibly trust somebody whose identity is a secret?
What the? Are you people not secret agents? What are you going on about, old man?
You're so old. Where's your wife? Go home to your family, dude.
Now we finally meet my favorite characters in the movie. I swear to God, as soon as I saw these people, I knew that I needed to make this video and share their gloriousness with the world. It's here we meet this random council of supervillains. Forehead, Queen Evil, Chrome Dome, and Crimson Ghost. First of all, can we just appreciate the stellar costume design on display here? So great. Second, do you think these villains are actually gonna do anything in this movie? If you answered yes, clearly you don't know what kind of fucking movie you're watching. These villains are here because Alpha Dog is pitching his world domination plan to them, which means instead of doing anything actually evil, they're just gonna sit in this room for the next 30 minutes of this 80-minute movie. I'm not kidding. I am so baffled by the existence of these characters. The fact that Forehead just looks like Oscar Isaac in Dune. The fact that Chrome Dome looks like a mix of Pitbull and the Supreme Sex Lord Ned. I have no words. I truly don't.
What is even happening right now?
Meanwhile, CIA is just vibing with Alpha Wolf's daughter instead of doing his mission for some reason. Then Alpha Wolf comes into the room and starts barking at a stuffed animal dog to remind the audience that he is indeed a furry. Then Alpha Wolf orders some pistachio ice cream and we cut to the chef having a meltdown.
What is even happening right now?
I don't know what the fuck is happening anymore or why my beloved CIA isn't on screen, but you know what? I can't even be mad. This is avant-garde storytelling right here. We then finally cut back to CIA for 10 seconds. Then we cut to Dr. Devious taking a nap. Riveting. And then we get to have some silly wacky shenanigans where Alpha Dog and his daughter are sitting too far away from each other at a big table while eating dinner. This is definitely necessary, guys. All of the scenes are absolutely crucial to the plot and cannot be removed, I swear. Oh no, now the girl at the agency has to go home because the adults are talking and she needs to be there to hear their divorce stuff, I guess. Thankfully, even this movie knows that's a waste of time, so it doesn't show any of that. But it does show our down bad friends trying really, really hard.
Nothing is constant but Sam. I can always count on him.
And me.
Will these two end up together in the end? Will CIA stop Alpha Dog and his evil machinations in time?
I think it's time we take this Megalodon down from C minor to B diminished.
And stack the four!
Tune in next week for the exciting finale, CIA's Finest Hour! You know, CIA managed to dodge that one shark, but can he dodge internet hackers trying to steal his data and expose his secret identity to the world? Well, he sure can. But only if he enlists the help of the one shark you don't want to dodge. Surfshark VPN. An incredible product that encrypts your data and protects you online. With Surfshark, you can trick your browser into thinking you're in another country, thus allowing you to access exclusive Netflix content you couldn't get otherwise. Literally just yesterday, I was like, hey, I want to watch the new episodes of Better Call Saul, which, contrary to popular opinion, is a show that I like and think is good. But the new episodes aren't on the US Netflix. Well, bada boom, I use Surfshark to switch to UK Netflix to watch it. That's so helpful. And you can do that too with this amazing VPN. Plus, you can use its Surfshark alert system to get alerts anytime your email address or password is compromised. Surfshark alert scans various databases of leaked information and notifies its users if their data is found so they can take action, which is an absolutely invaluable feature. They've got way better security than the embarrassing CIA agency run by this insane milkman. He'd probably spill milk on the servers and lose all your data, which Surfshark wouldn't do. Surfshark is also totally unlimited, meaning you can use it on as many devices as you like, even all at the same time. No other VPN allows this. Go to surfshark.deal/Rillis and enter promo code Rillis to get 83% off and 3 extra months of Surfshark VPN for free. It's an amazing deal, and it's even better because it comes with a 30-day money-back guarantee. So if you're not satisfied, you can cancel during those 30 days and get your money back. If you're looking for a great VPN, there's no reason not to give Surfshark a try. Once again, head to surfshark.deal/Rillis and enter the promo code Rillis. Have a great time with Surfshark VPN. Welcome back to CIAPE, where the Legion of Evil is still just vibing in this conference room, waiting for Alpha Dog. Then they start arguing with each other about random tedious bullshit. Alpha Dog tries to get them all to be friends. They don't want to be friends. And then he leaves. Fade to black. I'm pretty sure there's been about 15 minutes of plot relevant stuff in the first 45 minutes of this movie, and that's being rather generous. It's very cool that these characters don't matter at all. Oh, also, I bet you're wondering if they have any sort of evil superpowers or anything. You go ahead and keep wondering that until the day you die. That's what I'm gonna do. And yeah, I forgot to mention that pretty much every scene ends with a fade to black for some reason. It's like they edited this in iMovie and just used its most basic of tools. Seriously, how unprofessional can you be to use iMovie? I will say though, it's kind of amazing how competent the basic filmmaking is in this movie. Like, it's completely unspecial, but putting aside the bad CGI, the cinematography and lighting is genuinely better than most legit blockbusters out there. How fucking sad is that? Anyway, through the use of nanomachines, the robot dogs are now working, and Alpha Dog wants to celebrate the only way he knows how.
This is embarrassing.
Now, don't worry, guys. I can explain the thematic relevance of this scene very well. You see, dabbing is pretty epic. And by dabbing, Alpha Dog is proving that he is also pretty epic. Dare I say, he's even based. And that was my thematic analysis of this scene. Thank you all so much for the accolades and acclaim I know ahead of time this video will receive. Anyway, a mere 20 seconds after this epic dance montage is concluded, the movie tries to have an emotional moment where Bondi is saying how much CIAPE means to her. She doesn't want him to get killed, oh no. Trust me, I don't think CIAPE is in any danger when his biggest threat is this man. Also, hey wait, why is Bondi back at the agency? I thought she went home in the last scene. I don't know, maybe she was gone all night and then it's morning now, so she came back. Okay, whatever. Cut to the villain council. They just had pizza. Leto Atreides somehow managed to get a slice of pepperoni on his forehead eye. How did that even happen? Did he slam the slice of pizza into his forehead while trying to eat it? Why do these characters exist? And then we cut to Bondi at home. Wait, but then why was she at the agency in the last scene? The movie shows her leaving the agency for the day, then the next time we see her, she's already at the agency again, and now she's just not there anymore. Did they put the scenes out of order? Be honest, editor of CIAPE, you can tell me. We all make mistakes. I promise not to tell anyone else outside of whoever watches this video. So I guess that's a bunch of people. Okay, I'm bad at keeping secrets, sue me. But yeah, Bondi is sad because her creepy secret admirer didn't text back, and also her dad left her mom. Wow, how riveting. We then cut to Alpha Dog's daughter who's flying a kite all alone. Wow, it's like cinematic parallels even. They both have daddy issues, even though one's a hero and the other's the daughter of the villain. Whoa, this is mind-blowing parallel arcs going on, you guys. I love movies so much. And then CIAPE just strolls in the frame because I guess he has nothing better to do than hang out with his kid. He doesn't have a mission or anything. No siree. He's here for a relaxing tropical vacation. In fact, at this point, you start to notice just how little CIAPE there is in the movie entitled CIAPE. So many scenes just don't have him in them, probably because CG is expensive and hard, uwoo. But then, why did you make a movie about a secret agent ape then? Is it because you thought of the title first? It's because they thought of the title first, probably. I'd be shocked if that wasn't the case. But yeah, there hasn't been any action scenes with CIAPE since the beginning of the movie. Oh well, they're probably saving their budget for an epic fight sequence at the end. I can't wait to see what they come up with. We then have a scene that's actually trying to be emotional when the girl tells CIAPE about how her mom died of cancer and they spread her ashes on the surf and she likes to come here to be with her. And I'm sorry, do you see the problem with that sentence? This is a movie with a secret agent chimp. Why is it trying to be emotional? What's going on?
What is even happening right now?
And then of course that fades to black and just cuts to the agency where some random characters we've never seen before are talking about hacking and frozen pizza. pizza.
But I definitely wouldn't be eating that frozen pizza. You crazy? You don't like pizza?
I think the screenwriter just got really hungry for pizza when he was writing this movie, and that's why there's so much pizza in it.
Okay, I got the president breathing down my back. He's got a golf game at 11.
Yo, no way. They're gonna have a golf scene with Joe Biden in this movie? Hell yeah. Okay, so through the use of a random frozen pizza metaphor, these random kids we don't know explain they're gonna plant a worm virus thingy to ruin Alpha Dog's plan. So it's up to CIA to do that. He goes to Alpha Dog's daughter to get her help. And I guess the writers forgot he can talk halfway through the scene, because he just stands there silently while she asks him questions, even though he just said some random quip to her. But then they remember he can talk by the end of the scene because he does another quip.
Don't hate the player, hate the game. And don't call me monkey.
I guess he can only talk in quips. That is a cross he just has to carry. Alright, now it's almost time for the epic climax. The down bad boy is VR gaming for some reason, and the old man general's like, you know, I'm not comfortable using Alpha Dog's daughter for this mission. And it's up to Bondi to be like, no, yeah, this is good, Chief. Don't worry about it. This is totally ethical. She just needs to assert some independence and stand up to her father. Oh my god, wait a minute. That's just like Bondi. Holy moly, what a crazy coincidence. Okay, so the daughter gets Dr. Devious out of the room by saying that Alpha Dog needs him. And then she opens the door for CIA. That was it. That was her entire contribution to the mission. Couldn't CIA have just snuck in and knocked the doctor unconscious? What was the point of involving her at all?
You may be sly, but so am I.
Miss James, can we accomplish the task before us without bad James Bond dialogue accompanying it?
Hey man, he said it, not me.
Oh, come on, Chief. Where's the fun in that? This is a serious business, but a little levity is good for us.
She's not gonna fuck you, buddy. Give up. So Dr. Devious comes back and rambles about how he wants to make robot guinea pigs for a full minute, and it's not funny. All right, now it's finally time for the main event. Alpha Dream is gonna present his epic robot dogs to the other supervillains. This is a big ass deal. Pitbull brought his entire crew. The costumes on Leto Atreides' buddies look even worse than his does. That's not even getting into how wonderful the costume design is for Scarlet Witch and Purple Lady, wife of Purple Guy. You'd think a movie with functional CG, not good in the slightest, but perfectly functional, could afford something better for these hench people? Maybe? Or maybe I'm just dumb for expecting better. It's probably that. So the robot dogs come out, and the villains seem impressed at first. A little too impressed. Why does Forehead look like he wants to have sexual intercourse with these dogs? Oh well, it seems like all is lost for the side of good. Except don't worry, CIA installed the virus in the previous scene that makes the dogs go berserk. So there's no tension for mission control or for the audience. Just super realistic explosions and deadly spinning maneuvers that cause this witch lady to freak out. Call me crazy, but I don't think these are particularly good or competent supervillains. Like, they're all embarrassed by Alpha Dog, but at least he's making progress on something. What have you done recently to take over the world, Queen Evil? Oh, look at that. CIA is here to taunt them. That little stinker. Damn. Alpha Dog has gotta be pissed right now. I bet he's gonna take his revenge on CIA in an epic final battle for the ages.
Hold it right there, you simian savior.
Huh?
I think I owe you a bit of gratitude.
What?
If it wasn't for you ruining my day today, I wouldn't have realized what's truly important.
What?
No,
fuck off. No, come the fuck on, man. What are you talking about? Yeah, so Alpha Dog is incredibly happy that CIA foiled his evil plan because that means he can remember what truly matters and spend more time with his daughter and just stop being evil. He came to this conclusion off screen. That's it. There's no climactic ending battle. There are no action sequences outside of the first 10 minutes. We get a newspaper montage that I guess tells us Alpha Dog is in prison now, or at the very least, the doghouse. Maybe that's just his bachelor pad, I don't know. It's just weird to see him stop being evil and hug his daughter with no urgency, followed immediately by, yeah, he's in jail now, lol. But like, who gives a shit, so it's fine. Man, I wouldn't subscribe to Secret Agent Today newspaper. That's a surefire way to get my Secret Agent identity identity exposed. And if I'm not a secret agent, why am I getting this paper then? How can it possibly be the world's favorite newspaper if it's only available to secret agents? Why am I questioning this? I lost my mind watching this movie and I have yet to retrieve it. So Bondi reconciles with her dad for some reason. I don't know what prompted her to do that or why this subplot is in the movie, but yeah, it sure is. The old guy catches the frisbee before it can knock the hot dog out of his hands. Now that's character development. How beautiful. The mom asks who Bondi's secret admirer is again, and she and the down bad kid look really nervous about it. So, did they get together off screen? Did she turn him down but at least figure out it was him? Did they film a scene together where this is revealed and then forget to put it in the movie? I think it's the last thing. Also, they invite Alpha Dog's daughter over. Yay, aw, how wholesome. Then CIA winks at the camera and the movie's over. Wow. Well, that was CIA. Oh wait, hold on, there's a mid-credit scene, because why not, I guess. The mad doctor is in jail now, but someone approaches him to talk about his nanobot technology, and they ask what he requires of them.
C-I-A-P.
Okay, so I guess that's a tease for a sequel? Alright, very cool, CIA, very cool. Well, that was the movie. It was mostly just a grown man dicking around pretending to be a dog, joined by a stereotypical mad doctor mugging the camera, four weirdos in bad Halloween costumes vibing in a room, some random girl walking around acting sad, another girl saying dialogue that sounds like it was beamed to us from another planet, a boy desperately trying to get into her DMs, a senile old man who never leaves home without his rotten milk, three other kids having a socioeconomic debate about frozen pizza, and then occasionally we get a glimpse of the titular CIA sneaking around, but mostly just standing there and listening to the sad girl talk. And you know what? It was absolutely delightful. Life-changing, in fact. I do not have an ounce of hatred or distaste for this movie. It's CIAPE, man. The movie was the exact level of quality I was expecting. I did want more of the epic titular ape, but the surprises this work of art had in store for me more than make up for his limited screen time. The credits say that this movie was created by CIA Chimp LLC. Why did they name their LLC that and not just CIAPE LLC? Did they not think of the name CIAPE when they formed the LLC? Like, they were just gonna call the movie and the company CIA Chimp. Then they realized the obvious pun after the fact, but it was too late to change the company name. What's going on? Also, did you know the guy who plays Alpha Dog in this also played a doctor in Minari? Like, he was in a real movie? That's so weird. Anyway, 12 out of 10. The best movie I've ever seen in my life. I want Alpha Dog's chef to cater my wedding. Good night, Tri-State area.